Hello guys, welcome back to the G2 Esports Clash Legends Invitational. We are just before match 4 of the day, so we're almost halfway through. The next match will be between Crane and RDU, and we already know the classes of both players. So Crane is actually playing Warrior. So as we predicted, he's known for playing Warrior, and he is picking his most comfortable class. And RDU goes with the Druid. I wouldn't put RDU on any class, to be honest, because he's known as being just the aggressive player. So yeah. I'm not exactly sure which class would he pick, but he goes with the overall strategy that he is being comfortable with, right? So being the aggressor, being the player that puts the pressure on. So he picked the class that is best at it, right? Because it's so abusable with the innervates and the early board presence of the Druid archetype. So that's it. But for just the people that are tuning in to the tournament, let me just quickly explain what are the rules. They're pretty simple. Each of the player picks one class. You can only play one class. You pick two, then you build two decks for that class. They can be identical, but there's no reason to play two identical decks. So you build two. You might build two tempo mages. You might build a tempo mage and a freeze mage. But the deck choices in those decks can be different. Then you play a best of five, and no decks are being eliminated. If you win a game, you stick with your deck. If you lose a game, you can switch to the other choice or stick with the same deck. So the idea is here to get to replay a favorable matchup that you somehow lost, or to switch to a more favorable matchup because you predicted that outcome for your deck choices, right? So that's about it.
Yeah, so far in the tournament, we've seen it open up a variety of things. Firstly, as you say, people picking their favorite class, their trademark class. We've seen Zetalot going with Priest. We're now seeing Crane going with Warrior. Just classes that they're known inside out for, and classes that they know inside out. Ah, cat, hello.
Sorry, I'm so used to that. You know, she's doing that during casting. Not really thinking about it.
Yeah, what was I talking about? All right, yeah. So
comfortable classes.
Yeah, on top of that, so the other option is the more varied, the more well-rounded, the more universal players, people like Kalento and I guess Ecop and now RDU, as you say, aren't really known for individual classes. There, we've seen them kind of including tech cards to increase their chances against what they expect the meta to be. So we've seen Stan Sifka putting Sacrificial Pact in his Warlock deck.
Yes.
We've seen
two
Sacrificial Pacts, yeah. We've seen Harrison Jones in Tempo Mage from Oskaka. All sorts of things like that. Kezan Mystic in Reno Lock from Ecop. So all sorts of little twists like that. But see what we're going to come up with now. And we're going to see Crane. Looks like he is opening up with the Patron Warrior here against a unknown Druid of RDU. This could still be aggro or mid-range based on... See, usually Wrath isn't run in the aggro Druid, so we'd lean towards mid-range here, but...
And Shadow of Naxxramas is usually replaced by the Raptor, right? Because it's more aggressive, usually.
Yeah, sometimes there's like three drops in there, like one shade, two Raptors, two shades, one Raptor, etc. So I would expect this to be mid-range Druid, but there's still the opportunity. But yeah, as you mentioned before the break, Crane is quite probably the best Patron player in the world. He is sort of top 10 at will with this deck at any point. Just able to climb ladder with incredible efficiency. He's a player that, in fact, RDU and a lot of your G2 teammates, Life Coach, RDU, etc. He's a player that they've turned to practice Patron Warrior with in order to pick up the deck a lot better. So that's how well established he is in the pro scene. I kind of like correlate his position in the scene right now similar to where Oskaka was last year. Mm-hmm. But he has a tremendous amount of respect from all the pros as one of the best players in the world, but hasn't really had that big tournament breakout yet. So who knows, Lothar? Maybe this is his time.
Maybe. I mean, I'm kind of biased because, you know, RDU is part of the G2.
Yep.
But the one thing I really wanted to do in this tournament is to invite the people that usually are not playing in those invitationals, but are known for certain class, so like Crane at a lot, right? Those people deserve the chance to play their favorite class in a not a typical tournament, right? And hopefully they will do. We'll see how that goes. But now let's talk matchups here. If that's a Patron Warrior, yes. And it has to be, because you see two Dread Pirates, you see Unstable Ghoul. We don't see just the Patron yet, but in general, this matchup is favoring the Patron Warrior if you get the Patron Warriors out and combo them. Because then the Druid has a hard time dealing with the self-replacing minions. There's almost no way of clearing that. Unless you have a double wraps, Azure Drake swipe, or other ridiculous stuff. Yeah, and already a board control.
Yeah, some combination of three or four cards involving like Keeper and Drake swipe and Living Roots. And usually that'll involve an Emperor having to have happened as well to get it all in there, or innovates. So it's incredibly tough to deal with Patron boards. But honestly, this is one of the matchups where new Patron, the Warsong Lus Patron, new mid-range build, has probably actually benefited a little bit, because the new additions, like the extra mid-range minions, are actually even more effective against Druid. Having that Grom in there that you can use as a board control tool and a finisher, having Shredders, things like that, you can actually kind of go minion for minion with Druid early and win the game that way, as well as having the huge Patron win conditions. So I think this is actually one matchup where this deck is an improvement on the old Patron Warrior, as bizarre as that sounds to say, because that deck was insane. But yeah, Druid struggled against old Patron. I think it struggles even more so against new Patron.
That's a very interesting thing to hear, and I'm really happy that you brought that up, because I think it's a valid point. For RDU, it's important to have the Shade of Naxxramas as the only spot, because that's one of the minions that it's almost an immovable object for the Patron Warrior, unless he uses a Brawl, and most of the Patron Warriors aren't using that card anymore. So you either have to sacrifice two Whirlwind effects, and you don't want to do that, or you leave a one minion that is able to help clearing the board after you play the Patron Warriors, right? But in this situation, it doesn't look good for RDU. He is forced to use a Keeper as a silence effect, I guess, on the... Well, maybe not. What about attacking into the Unstable Ghoul this turn to trigger the Whirlwind effect and use the Keeper to want to kill one of the pirates? Because that setups a worse Battle Rage.
Yep, I like this a lot. Denying Battle Rage is one of the most important things. Yeah, it's one of the most important things you can do against Grim Patron Warrior. Battle Rage is really the key card that just can immediately blow out the game. I think as well, RDU would have recognized that the Fiery War Axis was basically just swung up face the entire time, so he probably puts Crane on a Death Spite here as well. So he doesn't want to just be too passive in his turns and let Deathspite come down. You know, this, if a Deathspite comes down here, he still has to trade down the board in order to use it efficiently. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I really like this play, and a little bit surprised that Crane chose to play out the Unstable Ghoul there because of the on-curve Keeper in that play that you mentioned. But I think his eyes lit up a little bit at the Acolyte of Pain draw, wanted to get that Unstable Ghoul down and into play just so he can start to get repeated value from the Acolyte.
But he had the Death Spite for next turn. I thought that was his line of play, to get the Death Spite out on turn 4, so I was kind of surprised by the goal as well. Because even if there will be a Keeper, you want to play the Death Spite, right? Because you kill it instantly. But you need also to kill the Shred of Naxxramas, because it's a threat that you need to take care of immediately. But now, wow, he left. I'm surprised by that. he left the Shadow of Naxxramas.
Yup. Chose to just take the immediate swing for 4 damage on the Keeper of the Grove. So his first swing of Deathspite did full value in picking up 4 damage. And I guess his thinking here is that whatever minion he leaves behind is probably going to trade with the Drake Corsair. And even if this Shade doesn't trade, he has the Emergency Slam to be able to deal with it next turn. So he can slam the Shade, swing the Deathspite, play Acolyte as his turn. So I can understand it a little bit, but just going back to the Unstable Ghoul thing, I remember having a conversation with Crane and RDU while RDU was streaming. RDU was playing Patron and trying to get some advice from Crane in the chat, and he queued into Druid and was asking, like, what should I, you know, should I keep this hand, should I throw it back, should I look for Patrons? And Crane's philosophy that he posted in chat was, generally against Druid, I just play my minions and then good things happen. So I guess that goes some way to explain why he just chose to curb out with the maximum amount of minions on the previous time.
Okay. I like this play, though. He didn't go for the greedy Battle Rage Acolyte. Sorry, he went for the greedy play with Acolyte of Pain and Slam, instead of using Acolyte of Pain, attacking the Shadow of Naxxramas, and having immediate card draw from the Acolyte of Pain, Whirlwind Effect, and Battle Rage. Because now he's, in theory, drawing more cards next turn, because he already saw two Keeper of the Groves, so there's no way of silencing the Acolyte of Pain. The only answer is a Wrath, which is was top deck right now. But
Even or if the Wrath swipe. Is played, yeah, Wrath, or if swipe. Wrath or Swipe is played, you're preventing your opponent from dropping Emperor on this turn, and also holding the Death Spite is a deterrent to Emperor. And turn 6 Emperor that goes unanswered is one of the ways that you can definitely lose this matchup as the Patron Warrior. So he's held double insurance here by making the Emperor a bad play because the Acolyte gets repeated value, and also just holding on to the Death Spite swing to deal with the 5-5 on this turn. So I really like this line from Crane for sure.
Wow, he goes for the Emperor. I'm surprised, to be honest.
Yeah, I mean, he's got a pretty nice hand in terms of, you know, things like he basically this gives him Azure Drake Swipe now at will if patrons were to come out. So I definitely don't hate this play, but we are going to see a lot of cards drawn this turn, I believe.
There's a lot of card draw. There's a chance that you will draw another Inner Rage or a Ruin Effect, and you can kill the Emperor without attacking it.
Yeah, there's also the option that I guess Crane is considering where he nudges into the Keeper first and then he draws Patron, which is a fantastic situation for him. But yeah, he's going to have to consider his line here.
That's like 1 to 18, I guess, to draw the Patron. Sorry, 2 to 18.
2 to 18, yeah.
Not the biggest chances to draw that, and you sacrifice a lot of potential card draw if you don't do that.
So he's going to go for the Inner Rage first. Yeah, actually, this is the best line, because he can still get Patron this way, but the rest of his play is identical. He'll still play the second Acolyte, he'll still hit the Emperor, and then he'll still trade into the Keeper.
Yeah, and he draws absolute disastrous amount of cards for you. That is a green Patron.
We've already established from the last game that I can't count to 12 or whatever it is, but yeah, he's drawing roughly 52 cards this time.
Oh my god, there's an Inner Rage Patron ruined.
Second Drake, alright.
There's no Savage Roar and no Force of Nature in the hand. What do you think about setting up already one Azure Drake this turn and using the Wrath to draw a card? Because you need that Savage Roar and Force of Nature as soon as possible.
I'm not sure if RDU will use the Wrath here. Having seen his opponent draw so many cards, I think he'll suspect there might be a Patron turn this turn. And we drew the second Wrath. I should use the 2-mana one now, I believe. Because finishing that thought, on the following turn, if Patrons were to come out, he will need Drake, Swipe, and Wrath to clear the board completely. And by using the 1-mana one there, he now actually doesn't have that play available to him.
But he might have been fishing for a Darkness's Aspirant.
Sure.
That's like two outs. Also a... No, that makes no sense. Only the Darkness's Aspirant is a draw that you could have played this turn. So I agree with you. It might have been better to use the 2-mana Wrath. Right. Even though it doesn't add up one damage to your opponent's face, and it doesn't add up the 1 point of armor.
Yeah. Oh, he used the cheaper Drake as well, I'm just noticing. See, you had to use the more expensive Drake and the more expensive Wrath to be able to make that play happen. So, actually, once he played the more expensive Drake... once he played the cheaper Drake, he actually couldn't have made that play happen, and he didn't have the second Wrath in hand. So actually, I guess, like, from a neutral standpoint of where his turn started, that play was actually fine.
There's a Savage Roar. But it's not... Well, you can go for the charging Druid of the Claw and Wrath. And Hero Power the 5-1. You don't need to Hero Power the 5-1. You can actually put damage on your opponent's face to make your opponent armor up this turn or play Armorsmith.
Yeah.
And then next turn you can Azure Drake Swipe that... crucial 1-mana Wrath on turn 9, or the cheaper Azure Drake would have been so important.
Right. Yeah, he's kind of stuck in an awkward spot here. As you can see, like, Spell Power Swipe is one of the best tools, but it's just not quite enough to deal with the most common patron board, which is just 4 patrons. And so, sort of talking about on the previous turn, but his mana just didn't really line up any way he did it, unless like he predicted that he was going to draw the second Wrath, which is kind of unfair to expect him to do. So just going to deal with it this way. I guess this is fine.
Well, he dealt with the first wave of patrons.
Yeah.
That's something.
Yeah, I mean,
but he used the Savage Roar. That's the problem.
Yeah. He used the Savage Roar, and the problem is that like he didn't get to consolidate a minion on the board, so he's now passing the tempo back to the Patron Warrior. And this is the situation that I was talking about at the start of the matchup. In the old Patron Warrior, in this situation, if they just went all in on their patrons and you cleared their board, they don't have follow-ups in their deck, because that was their deck. It was Warsong, yeah. It was Patron, it was Frothing Berserkers. Now, in this sort of situation where they've gone Patron, you've had to invest your entire turn into clearing, now Crane can just go Frothing Berserker, Sludge Belcher, or he can go Dr. Boom. Like, it's just totally up to him what he wants to do here. The initiative of the game is back in his hands. Well, he decides that none of those plays are correct, and in fact, the correct line is Unstable Ghoul, Armorsmith, Corcoran Elite.
I like that a lot.
Yeah, this is fine too.
And now it has to be double Pilot Shredders?
Double Shredder or Drake Druid of the Claw, I guess, are his options. He's seen one execute being used. It looks like he's going for Sylvanas Druid of the Claw, which I guess is fine too. The Sylvanas will take a little while to pick up its value. It's going to have that Unstable Ghoul to deal with, and that Battle Rage is pretty glorious here.
Now we can play the Prodding Berserker, tag with the Ghoul, draw from Battle Rage, and you have four chances of drawing the second Deathspite. What
now? Yes.
But the problem is there's still Sylvanas on the board.
Still the Sylvanas on the board. So at that point, like, you're looking to draw maybe Deathspite or Execute and then deal with Sylvanas, hope you don't lose the roll to take away the Frothing Berserker and go from there.
Okay.
That is definitely a line that we can go down. The other line is just to maybe play Dr. Boom and hope, but then how are you dealing with the 4-6? So yeah, I think regardless we see a Battle Rage this turn. It's just exactly how Crane decides to do this. It looks like he's going to play the Sludge Belcher to get the extra preventative measure from the Sylvanas from getting value. So I actually like this a lot.
Yeah, me too. You're
going to have a 5-4 Sylvanas up against a 3-4 Belcher. Goes ahead
and a second Armorsmith.
Battle Rage for 4 cards. I think we'll see this Execute used to push 5 damage here. Makes a lot of sense. No. Okay.
Oh, well, that's interesting. I was thinking about this, the Execute too.
With Grom in hand, pushing the 5 damage to face there seems reasonable. He has already used both Inner Rages, so his top decks for activating Grom are pretty limited. I think just one Whirlwind is what it comes down to, unless he's playing Cruel Taskmaster, which is a card that last time I checked with Crane, he doesn't favor in the deck at the moment. So.
But now, wait, how much damage is that? No, you can't activate Grom, so...
You have...
That's only 10 damage.
10 damage, yeah. So, looks like this is the turn where we're dealing with Sylvanas, because you seem to be able to do it relatively innocently this turn. You're not going to lose too much.
I wonder...
It's a question of how we're going to do it. You can trade off your minions first and end up losing nothing, more than likely. Let's see what comes out of the Shredder here. Micro Machine.
That's actually perfect for him. He can generate 4 armor that he just lost for attacking.
Right. Interesting. So...
Well, you know that your opponent doesn't have the combo, because he would have used that already.
Yeah.
Right? Would he, actually? The Belcher had 4 HP, so I think he would have used that.
Yeah, it was pretty clean into the Belcher. He could just send one tree in there, used his face to clear out the rest. So yeah, I think he probably would have comboed. Plus, you have already seen one Savage Roar being used, so... I'm going to choose to use the Execute here, and I guess this means he's not going to play any additional minions this turn. He's just going to double trade into the Micro Machine.
Oh my god, did he just roll?
Whoa! I think he played Boom.
No, he didn't.
Okay.
Oh my god.
I think this might be deliberate, though, because would you really want to play additional minions onto this?
Would you not Hero Power?
Oh, good point. All right, yeah. Yeah, all right, fair point. I didn't notice that the Hero Power was missed. You're totally right. So, yeah.
Well, this might actually change a lot.
Might. Are you going to go ahead and take his Armorsmith here? Crane, yeah, visibly a little bit shaken by that, just scratching the back of his neck, trying to recompose himself, but... Still, a Whirlwind draw can solve everything here.
But the Pilot Shredder is also might be concealing a Doomsayer too.
That's very true. Actually, a Whirlwind isn't good enough because of the stolen Armorsmith. We'll gain him the armor, so Grom Whirlwind wouldn't have been lethal.
Oh yeah, we're right.
That's actually funny. He's gonna have to find some way back onto this board now, because burst damage isn't gonna be enough as long as that Armorsmith is there. Because both Enrages are used, so any effect that he gets to enrage Grom will actually give more armor to the Druid. So he's gonna have to make a play for board here, and I guess the best play for board that you have is Dr. Boom.
And kill one of the Dancer's Aspirants or Armorsmith.
I think you're killing Armorsmith, right? Like with Grom in hand. Like
yeah,
you need,
I think you do.
If you draw Death Spite, you need that to still be lethal. So yeah, I think Armorsmith has to go down.
So Savador, oh, that's a whiff. Savador is 8 damage, so that's 12, 13, 16, 17 damage. 7 off lethal. Unfortunately for RDU, this now starts to look grim. He had a chance because his opponent slipped on a banana peel. And, now you're kind of... Now we're kind of in a really bad position, but I think the reason why RDU is in a bad position in general is because he messed up with the turn second micro mission.
Wow.
He did mess with that mess up with that Azure Drake less mana, and with the Rav that did cost less mana, and he went greedy for that hero power instead of preserving the mana advantage.
Well, that should pretty much do it. Crane can play this turn as safe as he likes. Try and kill one of these aspirants with a boom bot. Nope. All right. So if he trades the boom into one of them, Death Spite's face, or the other way around, it's not going to be lethal with combos. Yeah, nope. This should just lock up the game here.
Because he's still at 20 HP, and even though he has an innovate, RDU has an innovate that's only 15 damage with a Force of Nature draw. This turn.
Wow, alright, Crane's just gonna go for the full on board control play here. Nothing wrong with this either. He still deals with the expected outs comfortably. Swipe's not good enough, Druid of the Claw is not good enough, Big Game Hunter is not good enough. So this line seems totally reasonable.
Okay then. Seems like RDU lost the first game. We'll see how that goes in this second choice. I'm really curious, what is the second choice for RDU when it comes to the builds?
Mm-hmm.
Did he think about maybe countering a warrior? So maybe he has like Harrison Jones in the other build? Maybe he has, let's say, more silence? I don't know. That seems counterproductive when you have two Keeper of the Groves. So,
right.
Interesting game. I mean, both players seemed to make some misplays. Our Crane didn't play the Dr. Boom at all, so missed seven mana usage, and RDU was kind of ineffective with clearing. I mean, he was effective with clearing the board after the patrons, but the way he cleared the minions was putting him in an awkward position long term.
Right.
So this might be the reason why he lost that game instead of winning it in general, because the he could have turned the tables around with the Azure Drake that did cost 4 mana, with a swipe for 3 mana, and a wrath for 1 mana that could have been used after the turn. And just be kind of more greedy with the patrons, just leave them on board for one turn.
Sure, yeah, he chose to use his cheaper cards like to increase the number of top decks he can get, sort of open up things like Shade of Naxxramas as a thing he could play immediately. But I'm with you. I kind of would have valued keeping the maximum flexibility of the discounted cards. You know, I mentioned it right at the start of the matchup, is that the things you're going to need is like combinations of 3 or 4 cards usually discounted by Emperor. That's what he had. Mm-hmm. And he chose to throw some of those cards just out onto the board straight away. And just, you know, he was able to answer the patron board afterwards. But yeah, just handing the tempo back to the patron warrior. And tempo is now a thing that patron warrior can do. It's not a thing that they were able to do previously, but... You know, Crane just had a nice handful of proactive minions that he was able to get onto the board. And it looks like RDU is staying with his mid-range druid. So no info on what his second deck is just yet, but certainly doesn't feel like he has a better chance than he does with this one. And that is a pretty solid-looking hand for Crane. Frothing Berserker, fantastic opening. Deathspite, key card in just about any matchup for Patron Warrior. And then just another couple of extra minions that he can play onto the board to be irritating to the druid.
Exactly. Well said. And Also, the Corcoran Elite is an interesting choice in the Patron decks, but it serves a very peculiar situation. Role in the deck to kill 4 HP minions that are currently in the metagame, like can be in the metagame right now. So let's say Azure Drakes, let's say Savage Combatants. They can help out with the Belchers if you need to deal with them immediately, because you have so much ways of adding the one damage on top, right? So Corcoran seems like a very good choice in general in the Patron Warrior, and it also pressures a lot. It's like a Druid of the Claw without the taunt minion, without the taunt option.
Yeah, without the Warsong in your deck, you do just kind of need that extra teeth a little bit occasionally. You know, you can't be relied to draw Grom all the time. And also, Corcoran Elite can just allow you to tempo decks out of the game early. Matchups like Reno Lock, like Priest, you know, you get the early pressure draw down with the Corcoran Elite, and they're forced to use like key removals like Light Bomb, Hellfire, etc. to just deal with a board that doesn't even have patrons on it. And it just opens up a whole new win condition for you with the patrons afterwards. But as I said, Crane's philosophy in this matchup is play my minions, good things happen. And he has a nice pile of minions to play out of his hand right now. And Radu has missed most of his relevant ramp. He does have the Innovate Dr. Boom to come out relatively soon. So it looks like it's going to be turn 4 Shredder, turn 5 Boom.
And that looks good, unless there will be an execute for that Dr. Boom. And it is top deck this turn. So that's a thing that will help Crane a lot in this particular match, because otherwise he would have been left on in a position where he would have to take face damage, and that's a lot of pressure before the combo, so it wouldn't be really awful for him.
And it should. Just the way this is going to line up is going to work out really, really nicely for Crane. The Deathbite is going to come down, deal with the first half of the Shredder, and then the second swing of the Death Spite can deal with the second half of the Shredder and then execute the Dr. Boom. So
that changes the dynamic of the turn.
Yeah, now we have to trade. Okay. Alright. We're doing this, I guess. Seeing this Death Spite equipped and knowing how easily your board dies to the execute, you still go ahead and boom. And RDU says yes immediately.
I agree with him.
Yeah.
I don't think there's any other thing you can do in this situation. Because you put your opponent in a situation where he needs to have the patron right now. Mm-hmm. If he has the patron right now, he wins the game usually anyway. Because RDU has no way of making a comeback from patrons on turn 5 with a coin whirlwind. Or an innerate, or whatever can happen. So, I think the Dr. Boom was the only out to have anything against the patrons.
Yeah, agreed. Okay, Frothing does go down. Second bomb goes to face, though, leaving that Acolyte on board, which means it's threatening to get repeated value from the next Whirlwind effect of the Deathbite. And RDU just not really with a great deal to do. Loetheb, not the best draw, just gets immediately eaten by that Deathbite. It does force him to use it to an extent this turn, but I think he's going to be quite happy to do that with the double Acolyte play.
Yep. That's true. And also, RDU rolled rolled Snake Eyes on the Boom Bolts. They both dealt one damage each.
Yeah, I mean, I think he would have taken that as long as one of them hit the Frothing Berserker, because I don't think he wanted to spend his turn wrathing that last one health on the Frothing. So, oh wow, Crane's actually just going to go for tempo here instead of getting too greedy for cards, which is a little bit interesting. He doesn't have too much to do in hand, so maybe I would have liked to see him draw a few more cards, but he does have double Inner Rage that he can use to immediately cycle with that second Acolyte.
But putting four attack minion on board will deal with most minions
right.
Your opponent, and I actually like the Coconut this turn, because if your opponent wants to play Ancient of Lore turn 7, which is a default play for every Druid player on that turn, unless you have Dr. Boom, then that means that the Corcoran Elite will deal 8 damage to the face.
Yep, makes sense. And Slam is going to come down, clear this out nicely. Ooh, that is a draw right there. Belcher comes down, fills
that
out
is so
perfectly.
Cute.
And this, again, it's just, we haven't seen a patron drawn this game. And we see, even though the Warrior is at a very low health total, he's so far ahead on the board right now.
Well, that seems to be closing up the deal, at least from my perspective. It's 12, 14 damage, 17, 18, 20 damage this turn. Am I correct?
Well, Crane seems to disagree. 14, 15, 18, 21. No, it's 21.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah.
EU casting.
Yeah.
29 for sure.
Indeed. Well, that's one each, Lothar. That's our one for the day that we're allowed. it's in the Casters Union that you're allowed to miss one lethal every day. I don't know if you've signed this contract, but it is out there.
I got that middle of the way during the day. So
yeah.
Now I need to be careful. But it's 2-0 for Crane, and it doesn't look good for RTU. You know, what I like about this format is the fact that it resembles how do you feel when you're playing in a tournament in other card games. You know, when you have one deck, and you're just being queued up against an opponent that has favorable matchups. And
right.
Oh, damn. I was so unlucky in the pairings, you know? So this can happen. Not counting out RTU yet. Druid can do Druid things, but the problem is Patron Warrior is just great against Druid in general. And I'm sure the second option, like the second deck for Crane would be Control Warrior, and I don't see that being picked anytime soon.
Yeah,
even if he loses this even if he loses this match, he replays just the Patron Warrior against a Druid that he already faced two times.
Absolutely. And again, this is a pretty solid opening down the line of cards that Crane likes to have in his opening hand. He has the weapon just to harass the early minions, potential Aspirant. And I would expect to see him keep Ghoul into Acolyte as well. But I know he does like Frothing Berserker a ton in this matchup, so he might mulligan a bit more aggressively for that. But that is looking pretty juicy.
As a Patron Warrior.
Yeah.
This might be a... Oh my god. So now he just misses the Whirlwind effect. But he has Unstable Ghoul. So,
he has Unstable Ghoul, yeah. So he can try and time that to set it up. But I wouldn't be surprised to see him play it out for tempo here.
Really? On turn one?
Yeah. I mean, okay, he's going to play the Axe instead, which suggests that he's going to play the Unstable Ghoul next turn, play the Acolyte behind it. I mean, this is the line I was getting at. He's just choosing to do it in the other order. I probably would have coined the Ghoul and then used just War Axe from hand to maybe kill an Aspirant.
But if you coin out the Ghoul, that means you have the Fear War Axe in hand or a second Ghoul. Right?
Yes.
Because, or Armorsmith. But why would you... I'm just trying to catch a grip. And why would you play the weapon first instead of...
Right, I don't know, but I will ask Crane, and I'm sure there's some genius reason for it somewhere down the line, but I don't know. I definitely would have done it in the other order. You get to push an extra damage to face with the Unstable Ghoul as just a tiny concern, but I don't know. I guess just not giving Wrath as a turn two to your opponent is an option, maybe? I'm not sure. Just take out Wrath as a card for something they can play on turn two. RDU had the Wild Growth, so it didn't end up mattering, but I guess that's a concern that you can think about. And now RDU has to decide whether he wants to Wrath this now, whether he wants to keep it to silence it, but he definitely has to start thinking of ways to deny the Acolyte of Pain that's probably coming down on the next turn.
Yeah, so I would favor the Wrath this turn, just kill it immediately, and then silence the Acolyte of Pain if it will be played on turn three. And there's a reason why Crane was coining out a card on turn one to be on curve, right?
Yep.
So if he wants to be on curve, that means that there's a free mana card in his hand. If it's a free mana card, I don't think there's anything else apart from Frothing Berserker.
Frothing Berserker, exactly. And either way, like, you don't really want that Ghoul on the board with either of those. So.
Yeah.
Chooses to put the Patron Warrior to 29, which is an interesting decision because of that card right there. 29 is literally the best amount of health that a Patron Warrior can possibly have. It's strictly better than 30. You ask any Patron Warrior, they would rather have 29 health than 30.
29 for sure, man.
Yeah, exactly. It's the Patron Warrior's response. What's the best amount of health to have? 29 for sure.
What do you think about using the Keeper of the Grove that was already in hand instead of the one that was top decked?
I mean, I like it. You're giving... Okay, so the cards that are in your hand are cards that your opponent potentially has information on. You don't know what you've done. You don't know what reads your opponent has generated based on your actions as to what they might think one of those cards in hand is. The card that you've just top decked, there is no way in hell they have any information on what that card is.
Mm-hmm.
So by playing a card in hand, you're potentially removing information about your hand from your opponent's mind. Because they have that card that you just drew is a complete mystery. So if you reveal that card to them, the one that you just top decked, they may still have a read on a card that you have kept in your hand.
Okay.
So generally, I like playing it in that order. There is, of course, like the tilt factor that comes with playing exactly a top deck card. Say. Yeah.
You know what I do when I play like real life card games? I always try to tilt my opponent by saying, "Oh my god, I need this top deck," and then just like rip off a random card from the top of the deck. I quickly shuffle my hand with that card, and I'm like, "Yes, I did draw it from the top of the deck." Just to tilt my opponent like 3 times in a row.
Wow, you're just a scumbag, Lofa. Like,
yeah, man. Well, you know, you're playing for also for fun, like, and the psychological factor is a huge factor in games in general. So.
So,
too bad it's not possible in Hearthstone, but
there's some stuff you can do with, you know, timing your emotes and stuff like that that Hoy and a few other players have played around with in the past. But you're right, there's a certain thing that's missed from the face-to-face dynamic of other competitive games and physical card games, certainly. Just getting back to the game, RDU is staring at the decision between Shredder Hero Power and Sylvanas here. Looks like Shredder Hero Power is a pretty comfortable play. That Sylvanas isn't going to get a great deal of value on the board. Yeah. You're just kind of asking to get nudged by the Acolyte and executed. So.
And that's horrible. If you play Sylvanas, you need to use Innervate.
Yeah.
And I guess Innervate still holds value for turn 7 if you will have a Force of Nation draw, an example. Or you can benefit from, let's say, Ancient of Law into a Wrath. If there will be a free HP minion on board, that can be another Acolyte of Pain, that might be Corcoran Elite.
Yep.
A lot of options. So, yeah.
Yeah, for sure. And Frothing Berserker, another really great draw for Crane just to flesh out his curve. He's going to pray for no Millhouse Mana Storm here.
Oh my god!
Wow.
Why did you say that?
Where are my shoes? I need to put a shoe on my head right now. I promise this is not pre-recorded.
RIP headphone users, right? But oh my god. How many 2-drops are now in game? Like 80 something?
It's nearly 90. I think it's like 88 or something like that now. Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm. And it's golden too. No way, the value. 3,200 dust being spawned from a piled treader. Insane.
Well, bring on standard, right? We can just finally see the end of these piloted shredder nightmares.
Yeah, I just hate this card, really.
So if Whirlwind is drawn here, we're a little bit short of the full clear. He's one damage off killing the Sylvanas. He wouldn't really want to generate the board into Sylvanas anyway, but...
Slam.
This is such a huge swing on the board. Oh.
I guess it's Slam into Sylvanas. See what you draw. Kill the Sylvanas. You play what you draw, because it will be a 4-mana minion.
Yeah.
So maybe that's an option. Or an Armor Smith. Armor Smith would actually be really great here.
Yeah, Armor Smith is definitely not terrible, but I think we definitely start with the Slam on the Sylvanas, unless Crane has some other ideas that involve maybe playing Sludge Belcher and just axing down the 4-1, but I don't really see where that gets us. So I think slamming on the Sylvanas is definitely the right starting point for this turn.
By the way, Crane is like the second most... not moving person I have seen in the players' pro scene, right? Because the other one is Oskaka.
Yeah, Oskaka is stoic, to say the least. He definitely puts his game face on, doesn't reveal anything. Oh, wow, we're going to go Inner Rage, execute on the Sylvanas, and play the Sludge Belcher. So he's just going full tempo here.
Okay, actually, I like that. The problem is that you don't have the Inner Rage anymore for the Grim Patron.
Right.
Hmm.
I guess he's like considering, you know, maybe he can still be ahead on the board with this Sludge Belcher on the following turn. Seems unlikely with Druid with a bunch of mana to play, but you know, even Grim Patron slam your Grim Patron behind this Belcher is not a bad turn.
But now you have to innervate the low tip. 100%.
Yep.
Dr. Boom top deck.
Good. What do we get? Frothing Berserker is not quite it, and he has no answer right now to either of these minions unless he wants to spend his entire turn on a 7-mana slam, which does not seem ideal. But outside of that, I mean, what plays are really available to him right now?
Because of the low tap, there are none, so...
Yeah.
Seems not very optimistic for Crane, and it all turned... Like, everything went down because of that Milhouse Mana Storm.
Yeah.
That single drop from the Paltashrer changed the dynamic of the whole matchup. Whole.
Yep.
Which is the reason why we will be really happy after GVG will rotate out.
Yep. It was literally the only card that contests the Frothing Berserker. The Frothing Berserker was a 3-4, so Succubus would have traded. Doomsayer essentially would have, quote, traded. Like, Milhouse Mana Storm was the only thing that killed the Frothing Berserker and kept a minion in play itself, so... Literally, like, 1 out of 80-something that outcome occurs, and unfortunately Crane was on the losing side of it. But he is at a 2-game lead, so even though it looks like this game is slowly slipping away from him, he does have an opportunity to come back in one of the next 2 games and pick up the 3rd victory that he needs.
Now, back-to-back Dionysus Aspirant. We saw that last game.
Yeah, and it's just kind of one of the problems with the card is that once you get past maybe turn 3 or 4, you're essentially just drawing River Crocolisks off the top of your deck. They just don't have much of an effect on the game. So.
But they have a rider with a spear. Sorry, with a lance.
Yeah.
It's a lance, right?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a lance, I think.
Lance, okay. So, I just want to say that silence the Belcher to clean on... To have a clean kill on the Prodding Berserker. Oh, I was surprised by that, to be honest. I thought RDU will value more the attack to the face.
Well, I think he's just threatening lethal with this anyway, right? Like 2, 4, 6, 10, 15, plus 12. Yeah, he has 27 damage next turn with the Savage Roar, so.
But now he's. Let's imagine that there will be double Wyvern's effect, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then you are not threatening lethal. And he lost 5 damage because of that.
So what did he leave on board? The Sludge Belcher,
Sludge Belcher.
Which was injured, I believe?
No, it was a 3-5.
It was a 3-5, okay. But yeah, I mean, the minions are playing. You do always open up Battle Rage, attack into the 2-3 and Battle Rage if you leave it up. So I guess there's punishes either way, and he just felt like he was in a relatively comfortable position. Wildgrowth, not a great draw. Does at least cycle out of his deck. Cannot now play Force of Nature if he draws it, not enough mana. So he's going to be looking to pick up a little bit more pressure here. Swipe is not pressure, but it is damage.
Yeah, you played the swipe this turn. Because if you count on drawing Force of Nature next turn, you won't have mana to use it. And it gets kind of useless once a patron comes down the board. Well, you have board control, so maybe not that useless. So maybe you just go for the Savage Roar this turn to deal 8 damage?
No, I think if you're using one of these cards this turn, it is the swipe. You're pushing, what, 2, 4, 6, 7 damage without the swipe. So you'd put your opponent... I mean, you put your opponent to 14. He'd armor up to 16. So he would have to clear the whole board to prevent a Force of Nature top deck being lethal. Which seems kind of unlikely. It looks like RDU is just going all in here.
Almost.
Interesting. Yeah.
He keeps the swipe.
Interesting. So how much damage does he push here?
Well, that's 8, 15? 10, 16, 17. Right,
12, 15. No, it's 15, right?
Oh, sorry, 15, yeah.
So yeah, he's in trouble. Is Crane here. He's going to have to pick up... Execute won't keep him alive. He's going to need to execute plus something else, but he doesn't have enough mana to play it.
And
we're just in trouble here. Yeah, so he's just going to generate his board, hope that the last card in RDU's hand isn't damaged, but he's going to get the sad news very, very shortly that it is, in fact, a swipe, and RDU is going to inch his way back into this series.
Oh my god, the whiffs.
Imagine... RDU is so unlucky. He's drawing Innovator that situation. Damn.
I mean, you have to have... get some downsides in a deck that plays Innovate.
Yeah.
So that's one of the things that can happen to you for playing Innovate. But in general, RDU... Now, we can see some variance in the outcomes of the matchups, right? Because the patron is favorite in the matchup, but he loses 33... Like, he lost 1-3 of the matches, right? So we'll have a repeat of the game right now, because I'm sure as hell that Crane will pick the patron deck again, unless the second deck is a patron deck that is more teched against druids.
Right. Yeah, that's, but that's possible.
Is it possible? Because you already have such a good matchup against druids.
I mean, like, it could be a different patron deck that he just somehow feels has a better matchup. I wouldn't be surprised, like, with Crane's proficiency with Patron Warrior and how successful he is on ladder with it, I wouldn't be surprised if he just brought two different patron decks with slightly different twists on them. But it looks like he is just going to queue up the same deck again, which suggests that his other deck is a different type of warrior. But again, this is a favorable matchup for the druid, and Crane feels very, very comfortable in it. So he's just going to re-queue his patron deck and hope that he can get back to the winning form of the first two games and pick up a win.
Yep, completely agree with that. I mean, this is something that we anticipated, and this format can happen, that we will see a repeat of certain matchup a few times. But it's something that that is quite new to the Hearthstone scene in general, right? Because in no other format would have had that choice. But at the same time, it's favoring a player that had picked a certain strategy and is abusing it, right? I mean, it's something that you have in card games in general. So I like that from player's standpoint view. Like, an example, when you're the player that plays the patron deck, an example, so the Crane is super happy to be playing this matchup, right? But it gets kind of stale for the viewers right now, an example.
Right.
It's something that we have to take into account, but at the same time, it's favoring a certain player that picked a certain strategy. And I like that, because I like to see a player being rewarded by the deck choices that he makes.
RDU with a slightly goofy RDU smile on his face right now. I think the motion of his hands in the air was him saying to himself that Crane full mulliganed his entire hand, which decreases the chances of, example, Fiery War Axe being in hand. So he's trying to consider right now whether he coins out this aspirant and curves straight into shade, or whether he just passes and goes for a more consistent curve where he just coins out shade on the earliest opportunity possible. Like, they both still get shade out on the same turn. The difference is whether or not you have an aspirant. And obviously the first line is punished by Fiery War Axe and will actually delay your shade by one turn. But Crane thinking to himself and made a little motion in the air where he like seemed to indicate that his opponent full mulliganed, which he did. So that may be enough to convince him just to go with the aggressive line of the coin aspirant.
I think the coin aspirant is great. Like, your opponent had already three times in a row the Fiery War Axe. This might be the game when he doesn't have it. So... Why not?
Yep, and aspirant comes down, and as we see, there is no answer to it as of right now. Crane is going to have to work out his ordering of how he'd like to deal with this. The way his hand seems to deal with this is a combination of Unstable Ghoul and Slam over two turns. He has to decide which order to do those two things in, because he can Slam now to immediately draw the card, or he can just play the Unstable Ghoul to have the competitive minion in play. But then there's the potential that if RDU makes the attack, then the Slam will no longer draw a card. But if that happens, then the Unstable Ghoul will probably just be able to trade back into it anyway. But all of these things are things that are going through Crane's mind right now. And it's kind of fascinating to people who think, like, Hearthstone's a very simple game, right? You play your cards on curve and you trade where you can, you go face, etc. Like, all these decisions that we've seen in the space of each player's first turn, you know, we've both seen them think about two or three different options each just for their very, very opening turn before they even really have any options presented to them.
Yep, that's very true. And I like that a lot. I mean, those are the important things that will define the flow of the game for the next upcoming 4 to 5 turns, for example, unless someone plays an innovate, because that usually changes the whole dynamic of the game. I love this card, really, really. Mm. I think it's very balanced and adds another layer to the game. So hopefully it will rotate out too at some point of the game. But now RDU has no option, right? Because he can't really pass on a Shadow of Oxamas on turn 3, I think.
Agreed.
You can. And you need to keep the innovate for turn 5 Ancient of All. Because it looks like turn 3 Shadow of Oxamas, turn 4 Pile the Treasure, turn 5 Ancient of Law, and you're skipping the attack because you know that your opponent doesn't have the weapons, right? So, you know, there will be almost no option of of dealing with that Dunter's Aspirant unless he uses additional resources.
Yep.
Oh, look, there's a Fury War Axe. Kind of too late.
It is. And also, the fact the Aspirant dies on this turn with the slam interrupts the curve and means that RDU is just going to have to hero power down this 1-1 as his turn, be content with playing the Shredder on the following turn. But this
it's not terrible.
It's not terrible, but it gives Crane a little bit of a chance to just get some initiative back onto the board here, which I imagine he will probably do with the Corcoran Elite.
Yep, that's the turn 4 that you're usually missing.
Wild Growth, just a little bit too late here. Probably won't be played anytime soon. As you mentioned a couple of turns ago, Lothar, it looks like we're going to get Shredder into Innovate Ancient of Lore over the next couple of turns. It's just a matter of whether we choose to interact with this Corcoran Elite at all on this turn, and I don't think there's any reason to reveal Shade here. The Pilot Shredder already puts up a pretty nice trade against the Corcoran Elite. Even if your opponent has a weapon, there's a chance that a 3-2 minion or a Millhouse Mana Storm will come out of your Pilot Shredder and still be competitive against the Corcoran. Wow, okay. RDU seems to disagree. He's just going to make the defensive play, trades off his Shade, and just plays the Pilot Shredder onto the board.
Interesting
stuff. Yeah.
Okay, second Millhouse Mana Storm.
Yeah, here we go. I mean, he deserves a Wisp now, right? Like, yeah. 2-mana Wisp.
Oh!
No! Okay, what a good one.
Wow.
I mean, yeah, the Chains of Balance suggest that Captain's Parrot was the fair outcome from that Pilot Shredder after the Millhouse in the last one, but Hearthstone does not care about justice and just gives him, you know, we saw the best 2-drop, that's, you know, on par, it's in a small group that's probably considered the second best 2-drops altogether to get out of Shredder, so... yeah, RDU Shredder RNG is starting to put him in a pretty solid position in this series.
It's on point.
Yeah.
And now it's like, it's a clunky position for Crane because he plays a Shredder into, he plays a Belcher into a 5-5.
Yeah.
Which is a horrible position to be in, right? Fortunes for him, RDU didn't play a Wild Growth this game, so he's not, he has no option of playing Azure Drake into Raft, the 1-2, which would have been the perfect outcome. Because you set up a board, you still have a 5-2 and a 4-4 on board. So this is something you usually want to have. Still, that's the second option you can do.
Yeah. And just a tiny point. It's always interesting to me, in that situation, some players choose to silence the Belcher and then kill it, and some people kill the Belcher and then snipe the 1-2. It's exactly the same thing. Right? But, like, players choose to do it differently. And it's just, I don't know. It's one of the things that amuses me, seeing which players choose to do it which way.
Yeah, that's true. But in example, there's one thing that people always argue about, and it's about silencing a Neutron instead of damaging it. Because when I play a class that has a form of attack with his hero, I play small minions, I always use damage from the Keeper of the Grove, an example. When I can, because I don't want the Neutron to be without taunt. Because if there's another taunter being played, then you're able to kill it with an attack.
Yeah, makes sense.
Okay, so what's happening in the game?
Crane went for a small generation of patrons just to try and get some tempo onto the board. Didn't work out for him, was dealt with very, very efficiently by that Azure Drake. And now we might just be looking at having to make a Grom play onto the board just to try and get some board presence, but we see he's going to be passing back into 9 mana from RDU, who is sat with the Force of Nature Savage Roar hand. So it's looking like this game is about to be wrapped up fairly quickly as well, unless Crane makes a hyper-defensive play, but even then, I believe he's still dead, right? What's the most defensive play he can make?
It's
Dread Corsair, Unstable Gull, Armor.
That's 17 health. Two of the Treants are going into the Taunters, and then you have 4, 6, 11, 15, 19, 17, 19 damage.
Yeah, so he's still going to be dead either way. Looks like he's just going to fish for a better answer with...
Execute or a second Whirlwind Effect, but the time is going away.
Yeah, just not good enough. Plays the Acolyte onto the board. Prays, crosses his fingers, hopes that there's no combo, but RDU has him covered pretty comfortably here. attacks first with the Ancient of Lore, since that was going to die anyway. Just good ordering, and then just the combo plus the extra Azir Drake clutches it out. And RDU, fighting his way back up, back in this slightly unfavored matchup, pulls himself back to 2-2. And Crane, I'm sure, will just queue up again, and he'll just be praying to see that Death Spy Inner Rage Grim Patron hand come up in this deciding game.
That's true, and now it kind of looks grim for Crane, right? Because he lost two favorable matchups in a row, and it has to affect his mindset a little bit, right?
Yeah,
I guess that will be the case with most players, unless you're like this stone cold Austin and you don't have any feelings at all. But we'll see how it goes. RDU has an innovate in his opening hand.
Yeah, I mean, RDU pulls the seems good face, innovate Shadow Next Rammer Shredder. That seems like a hand you're going to keep. Crane, on the other hand, is a long way away from patrons, but does have another one of those hands of just early minions.
So he just needs a top deck with a Wildgrove.
Yeah.
And if he does that, then it's turn one Shadow of Next Rammer, turn two Wildgrove, into turn three Piltor Shredder, which is amazing against any kind of deck. And especially against a deck that relies on weapons to kill the minions, because then you just push so much pressure early game.
Right, and Crane is just debating whether this hand is good enough right now. He might want to push a little bit harder for a Death Spite, and then there's the debate about whether you even keep the Dread Corsair if you're looking for Death Spite, but I think Armorsmith is definitely a keep. It gives you a lot of flexibility of being able to deal with Darnassus Aspirant if you miss your Fiery War Axe. If you coin out an Armorsmith... Oh, wow, he disagrees. Okay, I was just going to say, like, Armorsmith, if you coin it out and then your opponent responds with Aspirant, you can then have Inner Rage, Slam. Like, you can have a variety of options that help you trade into it really efficiently. But Crane decides that the Armorsmith is not good enough and he'd rather have it in the late game as a option to bounce back his health with Whirlwind effects against a possible combo. And he does get rewarded by picking up two different weapons here. So
yeah, that's true. If he picks up again the Dread Corsairs, that would be awesome for him because now he has an option to innervate them by playing the weapons. And the problem for RDU is the fact that now that he picked Dr. Boom, so he can't really innervate Piltor Shredder this time. Because first of all, it dies to the Fear War Axe, and unless you have second Totem Golem or second Miller's Mana Storm, that's not a good trade right now, because you're playing into a curve, right? Because you will after the next one you will play Shadow Next Rammers, but then you sacrifice the option of playing Dr. Boom after the usual curve. So you sacrifice turn two, which is not that important against a warrior right now, but you have the option of playing turn 3, turn 4, into turn 5, Dr. Boom. Which I think is more valuable in this matchup in general.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. Based on the Dr. Boom draw, that definitely seems to be his curve. Shade into Shredder into Dr. Boom on 5. We do see now that Crane has lined up the Deathspite plus Patron combo. So he has a couple of draws now to pick up either a Whirlwind that he can use with the coin or just an Inner Rage that he can use naturally. And recognizing that he was going to want to equip that Death Spite as soon as possible, he's just going to start wailing on the face with that Fiery War Axe.
that just tells you...
Oh, well... Oh,
okay, well... But would you do that?
I mean...
Would you do that? Because that's the question. You know that Warrior is one of the classes that can, especially Patron, that can punish you by playing a single AoE and Execute. Even if he doesn't have the AoE, then you can just attack into the Dr. Boom and execute it. But RDU doesn't care, he just slams the Dr. Boom on turn 3.
I mean, there are things that can punish turn 3 Dr. Boom. You know, most decks can have like a big game hunter, you know, various things. But like, if you're going to ask any player on Earth a question of, you know, do you want to play a turn 3 Dr. Boom? The answer is probably going to be yes.
Probably.
RDU agrees, the Dr. Boom comes down, it is going to get executed here, and hopefully, from his perspective, that Acolyte picks up some value against the Boom Bots, and it looks like it might do, because RDU's play here is to swipe it. So.
I think I would immediately swipe it, because you deny the multiple card draw from the Acolyte of Pain, and you know that your opponent doesn't have an option of playing a Whirlwind, so those Boom Bots will stack up damage. they will have value next turn because they will attack for two this turn and attack for two damage next turn. So that's four damage in general, in addition to the bombs having the RNG effect built in.
Actually, I find that argument quite convincing. I think we're going to swipe it. Yeah, I like it, actually. Also, like, playing a minion just kind of plays on curve into what your opponent's going to do, which is Death Spite, and there you go, Lothar. After we both agreed that swiping the Acolyte was the play, Crane just goes ahead. Sorry, RDU just goes ahead and drops the Pilot Shredder. So.
I really didn't like that, but we'll see. Maybe the RNG... unfortunately, didn't work. Because now... Crane is able to play double free minions for free. I mean, my pronunciation actually made that immediately impossible to for most people to understand, but I guess you can see for yourself what I meant.
Wow, he hit the boom bolt instead of the pilot shredder with the death bite swing.
Yeah, I'm kind of surprised by that. Maybe he knows that there will be a 3-4 or 4-4 minion.
Yeah. So why would I turn this 4-3 into a 4-4? That doesn't make any sense. but he, like, that extra card draw has allowed him to now pick up that inner rage. So he is going to go onto the patron plan next turn. And with double battle rage in hand, he can then very quickly turn this empty hand into a handful of armorsmiths and whirlwinds to then restore his health. So even though this has been a brutal opening from the druid, Innovate Dr. Boom, followed up by a curve into Shredder. The Patron Warrior is keeping pace somewhat here, has a decent board to contest this Shredder, and then next turn he is going to go off extremely hard.
Now let's think about, I just want to go back to the turn, to the previous turn, right?
Yeah.
If there would have been a swipe instead, how would it look like? You would still have two bombs on the board.
So it'd be the same situation, but there would be significantly less cards in hand for Crane. So that second Battle Rage and the Inner Rage would not be there.
Mm-hmm.
And it would be two bombs against the 2-3-3 Dread Corsairs.
Maybe one bomb, because he would have attacked.
Yeah, maybe he would have hit one. Yeah, sure. Anyway, patrons have happened. Actually, the first time against Druid since the first game, actually. Crane has generated the four patrons, which is kind of the dream scenario in this situation. Has the Dread Corsair to protect the 5-1 from the hero power. It's going to be a little bit inconsequential because we do see the swipe, but swipe just cannot be used here because without the spell power buff, there's just no way that swiping this board is effective. If you're going to swipe anywhere this turn, you're going to swipe face.
Yeah. Maybe that's actually the play. Because you can deal 5 damage to the face, you'll be... And no, you don't have an option to lethal next turn anyway. Huh. That would be an interesting actually play if there will be a potential lethal next turn.
Right.
But in this situation, that's not possible. And he just whiffs on this turn. He needs to play Emperor. And he gets 12 damage, 15 damage to the face, 19 damage to the face next turn if Crane goes super hyper aggressive.
Yeah, and with those two Battle Rages in hand, as I said before, it's so likely now that having sent that first Armorsmith back from his opening hand, he now has both Armorsmiths in his deck, which means he can draw so many cards this turn with Battle Rage if he would like, if he wants to pass up the Corcoran Elite tempo play, that he's almost guaranteed to hit at least one Armorsmith and be able to start restoring some of his health over the next couple of turns.
And,
Alright.
Battle Rage first, right?
Yeah, at least one Battle Rage gets played for sure. That's four cards. There's the Armorsmith. And, alright, so trade the 5-1 Armorsmith Unstable Ghoul seems pretty reasonable.
I don't think I would play the Unstable Ghoul. I would favor the Weapon and Armorsmith.
Weapon and Armorsmith. Do you change the clock by playing the Weapon, is my question, though? So you're going to push 3, 6, 9, 12 this turn. You can change that to 15 with the weapons. Yeah, you actually do change the clock, so I don't mind playing the weapon here instead. Because this way you're doing 12, he's going to be at 16, and then you have 12, 14. Yeah, so actually... 12, 14... No, I mean, it's the same clock either way. You still kill him next turn.
Okay.
So the Unstable Ghoul is pretty reasonable here. Just to... create a bit more insurance against a scummy combo win, because, you know, you did see your opponent play Emperor the previous turn. So
yeah, that's actually okay. I forgot about the Emperor factor.
Yeah.
Yes.
So Force of Nature Savage Roar can come out here. He does have the 3-1 taunt in the way, but, you know, Force of Nature Savage Roar, 0 mana Living Roots, something like that. Like, that could happen and you could lose the game. Swipe comes down here from RDU. I think this is just a concede. I'm not sure.
It's just too much armor at this point.
Yeah. So the ghoul is going to go off here and overfill the board with patrons, I believe. No,
but it would generate two anyway.
Yeah, that last one in the middle is going to die anyway, so it's not even overfilling. And yeah, it is just, in fact, RDU playing Concede Druid. He concedes the series 3-2 to Crane, who edges out a favored matchup in probably a score that's reflective of the overall matchup in general. I think, like, 3-2 is about how favored that matchup is for the Patron Warrior.
You think so? I would actually bet on 3-1 in this matchup more.
I mean, that's 75% win rate. That's pretty huge, right?
Well, yeah, okay. Yeah, okay, you're right.
Yeah.
But it, in general, I would say it's about 60.
Yeah, I'd agree.
So,
yeah.
It's favorable. Yeah. Anyway. Congratulations to Crane. Too bad for RDU. He's out of the tournament because it's a single elimination tournament. But we will have Crane in the top 8, and he will be paired against... who was the winner of the previous game? Let me check, because I can't remember really too much matches. Too many matches. So he was playing against Ekop.
Ekop, who beat Oskaka, yes.
Yes, and now we'll be going into a short break before next match will be, which will be Life Coach versus Elky. So two ex-poker players.
Yeah.
Well, Elky actually still plays. So two poker players playing against each other in a Hearthstone game. Woo! Oh. So don't go anywhere. This is G2 Esports Class Legends with only one class for each player. And we'll be right back after